الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And those who are feeling a little bit left out, happy Wednesday Mubarak to you all. Wajahat, he outlined the reality of the Muslim community here and the ongoing attacks that the Muslims are experiencing to the extent that the Prime Minister of the day, David Cameron, he found the time in his busy agenda to comment where Muslim students actually sit at universities. Can you believe that? He actually commented as to where Muslim men and women, they sit in university halls. As if the government doesn't have more important and pressing matters related to the economy, related to unemployment, crime, social issues. But the burning issue for the Prime Minister was to actually comment as to where Muslim men and women actually sit in Islamic gatherings, and which ensued this whole debate about gender segregation, so-called gender apartheid. I want you to just think about that. It's not any kind of a leader here. You have a leader of a developed, industrialized, capitalist nation who decided to comment about where Muslim men and women actually sit, which is very telling as to the position and the situation of Islam and Muslims on the minds and the hearts of the politicians in the West. Really telling. What is really interesting is this whole debate of Muslim women and men, where they actually sit. Muslim men and women, they've been sitting in segregated halls, in functions for decades. 10, 15, 20 years ago, this was never an issue here. Never an issue here. Why is it an issue all of a sudden? Why is it an issue all of a sudden? And it's all linked to the whole notion of extremism. Now, subhanAllah, I was just jokingly saying to some of the brothers that next thing they will say, غَدُّ basar, lowering your gaze is going to be, you know, this is extremism. As Muslims, what do? Part of our social etiquette. We actually lower the gaze. Next thing, they'll be monitoring as to where you're actually looking. If you are directly looking at the face of the woman or not. If you're not, then you will be branded as an extremist. Where does it stop? If it is about gender segregation and where men and women sit, next thing it will be about where do you actually stare. This is the reality of what is happening in Britain and throughout the Western world, that Islam and Muslims are on the spotlight. What I don't want to do today is really go through all the various issues and incidents that's been taking place, whether it's the cartoon issue, whether it's the attack on the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether it's the issue of segregation, whether the issue of, you know, Muslim men and women working in Marks and Spencers, can they sell alcohol or not? These are ongoing issues. And one thing that we must accept, that Islam is on the agenda of the West, and Muslims are on the agenda, and it's here to stay. And those who are thinking that this is just a, you know, it's an incident, it will just blow away, let's just forget about it and not think about it, they are really living in cloud cuckoo land. They need to wake up and really smell the coffee, really. What is happening around us? Now, how do we as Muslims respond to such a situation that we find ourselves in? How do we respond to the ongoing attacks on Islamic thoughts, ideas, values, and our practices? What do? And the beautiful thing about Islam, when Islam is attacked, Islam tells us how to defend itself. That is the beautiful thing about Islam. Islam is bayinatan min al-huda. It is a guidance, and it's an explanation of the guidance itself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave this matter of how do you defend Islam, how do you defend this deen of Allah you know, without any guidelines and without any thoughts or ideas or values, and leave it to us to decide as we want. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has instructed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about how we should carry Islam. And I want to really focus the rest of my presentation of this ayah from Suratul Nahl, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam towards the end, saying, "Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'idhati al-hasana wa jadilhum billati hiya ahsan." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after talking about the virtues of Ibrahim alayhi salam, is addressing Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam with a command. "Udu'u ila sabili rabbika." Call, give da'wah, invitation, "ila sabili rabbika," to the path of your Lord. Now, a command to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a command for Muslims. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam has been commanded to call people to Islam. It's da'wah. And we are commanded to call to people to Islam. I'll tell you one thing today, brothers. Da'wah is becoming a negative word, because da'wah is now associated with extremism. Because calling to Islam is a form of extremism today. So someone who's a da'wah carrier, he will be seen as an extremist. He will be seen as an extremist. We as Muslims, we are commanded to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's been commanded here to call unto his, to the path of his Rabb. And what is important in this ayah, because this word, udu, to call, normally you call something to something. You call something to something. So the scholars, when they looked at this verse, they said, where is the object of the call? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's been to call people to the path of his Lord, but has not mentioned who should this call be directed to. Should it be directed to the mushrikeen of Mecca, to the Ahl al-Kitab, the Jews and Christian? It has not been mentioned. So why hasn't the object of the call not been mentioned? They said the reason why it has not been mentioned is to create an impression of generality of the call. I mean, this da'wah is a general da'wah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not specify that this call is restricted to the Arab mushrikeen or to the people of the book. So we have to think now that who do we call in our reality, in our situation, in Britain? Who is the object of this call? We are living amongst Muslims and we are living amongst non-Muslims. So we have to really think deeply about who is the target audience of this call, of this da'wah. Now, if we look to the reality here in this country, the target audience of the da'wah of Islam, there are really three groups. In my mind, there are three groups of people that we need to really think about, and they broadly can be categorized as follows: the Muslims. There are more than 2 million Muslims in this country. And the Muslims, we have a mixed picture here. Some Muslims are practicing Islam. Some Muslims are not practicing. Some Muslims are going on the path of moderation, this moderate Islam. So we have the Muslim community. And we have to think about the da'wah to the Muslim community according to the needs of the Muslim community. So that's one group that we have to really think about deeply. The second group is non-Muslims who are really victims of the media propaganda and the policies of the government. And they are our neighbors. They are our colleagues. They're the people that you actually buy and sell on the high street. The general, average Joe. The non-Muslims. And really, they are none the wiser about Islam at all. And they get their information about Islam from the news channels, whether it's the BBC, the Channel 4, or that, you know, great intellectual newspaper, The Sun, you know. So that's where they actually get their information about Islam. And that's an audience that we have to deal with. We have to think about how do we carry da'wah to. And then we have a third group, which is the elites of society, the media, the politicians, the people who actually have an agenda against Islam, who are actually working day and night to demonize Islam and Muslims. So we have three groups of people that we have to consider in our da'wah. The Muslim community, the average non-Muslim who are none the wiser, who are victim to the propaganda about Islam, and then you have your elites of the society, the politicians, the journalists, the policy makers, who have an agenda and who are working day and night to actually criminalize Islam. Now, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to address the manner in which we carry Islam. What is the manner? What is the way that we should carry Islam? He says, bil hikmah. Now, with wisdom. Now, this word wisdom, hikmah, unfortunately, today, hikmah in the minds of many Muslims means compromise. When you say, when you hear the word, akhi, have hikmah, it means have compromise. That's what hikmah means. Hikmah means, in the minds of many Muslims today, that look, there is the haq and there is the batil, but the path of hikmah is in the middle path, between haq and batil. This is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, call unto your Lord with compromise. He does not mean that. Bil hikmah. What does hikmah, the word hikmah means? One of the mufassirin, Ibn Hayyan, he said, Al-Hikmah said, وَهُوَ الْكَلَامُ سَوَابُ الْقَرِيبُ الْوَاقِعُ مِنْ نَفْسِي أَجْمَلَ الْمَوَاقِعِ. It is the correct concept or speech which goes into the soul. It penetrates the heart. Another scholar, Az-Zamakhshari, in his tafsir, he said, Al-Hikmah, bil-Hikmah, he said, bil-Hikmah is bil مقالة المحكمة الصحيح وهي الدليل موضح للحق للحق المزيل للشبهات. It is the precise and clear speech which is, it has a clear evidence for the truth and removes the doubt. It is the precise and clear speech which has evidence and it removes the doubt. I establish the haq. So this is what hikmah is. Hikmah is the correct and precise speech which is there to remove any doubt and to establish the haq. So that means when we are carrying Islam, we have to carry Islam with hikmah, which does not mean compromise. That means as a community, as those who are carrying the da'wah of Islam, we must really understand what is Islam. Because how can we carry Islam if we don't understand Islam today? How can we carry this da'wah if we understand Islam to be merely praying and fasting and good akhlaq? And we don't understand Islam as a comprehensive way of life? So the Muslim community who are going to be engaged in this path of da'wah and struggle, they must acquaint themselves with the knowledge of Islam. And that means the Sharia of Islam. That means the Aqidah of Islam. Not only that, it means to know the reality also which we live in. What is the reality that we live in today? What is the situation that we live in today? What are the current trends in the Muslim community today? What are the current trends in the society today? Because we must have clear awareness, ala basiratin, upon a clear vision. Like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had, that he knew exactly what is the situation in Mecca. In situation Mecca, time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was 360 idols today, then, and which were being worshipped. But we don't physically have 360 idols today in London. Physically, we don't have that, which are being worshipped. But we do have something as equivalent. We have over 650 idols in a place where Allah and Al-Uzza used to sit in Mecca in a place called Parliament today. They are the Allat, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat of our days today. They are the people who are making the laws, the legislation for the entire society. People might not call them, you know, gods. People might not see them as statues being worshipped, but they legislate and people obey. So that means the reality of democracy today, we need to understand it very clearly. Like how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Sahaba, they understood the shirk of their time. So it necessitates that we have hikmah, and that hikmah means that we study Islam, we study the contemporary situation that we live in today. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has been commanded to carry Islam with hikmah, but also وَالْمَوْعِذَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. مَوْعِذَةِ means admonition, to give advice. Now, when you have hikmah, when you have the knowledge, the ilm, the correct speech, now that correct speech, you need to think of ways and means and styles of how do you deliver that and how do you actually convey that to people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you need to give admonition, a good advice to people. Now, you know what? People don't like to be advised. Seriously. No, who likes to be advised? None of us like to be advised because nobody likes to be told you're wrong. Generally, when someone says, I've got some advice for you, your heart is pumping away, your survival instinct is really high. Why is it? Why? Because nobody likes to be criticized. Nobody likes to be told they are wrong. Generally, you give advice when you notice something which is wrong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that this is the condition and the situation of the people, this maw'idh has been qualified with hasana. A good advice. A beautiful advice. Meaning that when we are carrying da'wah to people and we're giving them nasiha and advice, wallahi, there is no hidden agenda from us. We don't seek anything. We don't seek any money. We don't seek any position. We don't seek any power. We don't seek anything at all. That this da'wah that we are giving is sincerely for the benefit of the people. Is sincerely for the benefit of the wider society. And people need to sense this, that the Muslim community here in the West, we are not a fifth column. We are not a fifth column. We are not something that should be been afraid of. The wider society should not think the Muslims are hidden enemies. They should not think that from us. We are open. Our masajid should not be thought of as, you know, terrorist schools. Our madrasas should not be thought as of, you know, where we brainwash our children so they become violent extremists. No. They need to feel from us that this maw'idha, this Islam that we carry, is with sincerity and with intention and with hasana. And we need to, that means we need to be open to the wider society. That means we need to be open with our colleagues, with our neighbors. And in our style of da'wah, the way we carry da'wah, our da'wah is really according to the situation that we find ourselves in. When you think of the best usloob, the best styles. And we don't want to be angry da'wah carriers. You know the angry da'wah carriers? It's like, man, these kafir. Man, these kafir. Damn, these kafir is going all red. We don't want to be angry da'wah carriers, no. We control ourselves and we want to give da'wah in the best possible way. The best possible way to our audience. And I want to give you an example. I want to think about this example from the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was the embodiment of a da'wah carrier. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ. Who is better in speech than the one who calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And he embodied that, how to carry the da'wah. Let me give you an example about a boy, a young boy. He came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And think about this. And think about how you would respond to this situation. He said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, give me permission to do zina. Many of you are saying, Astaghfirullah. Many of you are saying, Astaghfirullah. Guess what the Sahabas were saying? Astaghfirullah. They were saying, Astaghfirullah. Yeah, and they were like really, really upset. They were rebuking him and saying, stop, stop, stop. A young man is coming to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's asking for a license for zina. How many of us, how would we respond to that? And look at how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he really embodies carrying the da'wah, ma'udhatul hasana, good advice. He said to him, Udnuh, come close. He's calling the boy, come close. And he said to Mijlis, sit down. Look at that. Come close, sit down. Many of us will be like, where is he? Where is the jota? You know? Where is the sandal? Where is the sandal? Rasulullah ﷺ saying, come close, sit down. The Prophet ﷺ said, would you like it for your mother to do that? Would you like it for your mother to do that? The young man said, no, by Allah, may I be ransomed for you. I would not like this for my mother to do that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَلَنَّاسُ يُحِبُّنَهُ لِأُمَّهَاتِهِمْ. And the people would not like this for their mothers to do that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَحْفَى تُحِبُّهُ لِإِبْنَتِكْ. Would you like this for your daughter? Would you like your daughter to do this act? He said, no, by Allah, may I be ransomed to you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَلَنَّاسُ يُحِبُّونَهُ لِبَنَاتِهِمْ. The people would not like this for their daughters either. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, أَفَتُحِبُّهُ لِأُخْتِكَ. Would you like this for your sister? Are you this permission to do zina? Would you like it for your sister? He said, no, by Allah, may I be ransomed for you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him again, وَلَنَّاسُ وِحِبُّونَهُ لِأَخُوَاتِهِمْ. And neither the people would like this for their sisters. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said, أَفَتُحِبُّهُ لِعَمَّتِكَ. Would you like your aunt? Would you like this for your aunt to do this? He said, no, by Allah, I don't want this. May I be ransomed for you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, neither will the people would like this for their aunts to do this. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked, he made a dua for this man. He said, Allahumma ighfir li dhanbahu wa tahhir qalbahu wa ahsin farajahu. O Allah, forgive his sin, purify his heart and guard his chastity. And after that, the young man never paid attention to doing this such a thing. This is how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used the hikmah, the knowledge and the ilm in conveying the da'wah. And we need to think of how do we convey this da'wah in this beautiful way. Now, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions, وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. And argue with them in the most beautiful way, in the best way. Now, when you argue, you're arguing because there is a dispute. There is a conflict of opinions that exist. So in Islam, there is a situation where we must argue and debate and discuss. Some Muslims, unfortunately, they think all arguments and all disputes that Muslims should stay away from. No. There are certain types of arguments and certain types of disputes it's wajib for us to actually get involved in. Especially regarding Islam. وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Now today, this third group, which I mentioned to you, to the Muslim community, you have the non-Muslims who don't know anything about Islam, who are victims of the media propaganda. We need to invite them to Islam with hikmah and with good preaching. But there is that third group, which is the politicians, which is the journalists, the policy makers, who have an agenda, who are disputing Islam, who have certain views about Islam. They consider gender segregation a form of oppression against women, where they think liberating the women from the sink and chaining it to the desk is a form of liberation for the women. Seriously. The women, they think they've liberated them from the sink, now they are chained to the office desk. That's a form of liberation. So they are challenging Islam. They think the hudud of Islam is oppression, where hudud of Islam is justice. They think that the Sharia is backward. They think that the Khilafah is some sort of religious dictatorship. These are the views people carry. And they're hurling these views against Islam. And we must engage in that debate, engage in that discussion. And that means that we need to know the arguments. You cannot actually engage in a debate if you don't know what your opponents are saying, can you? You cannot. Then you'll just be engaged in a one-way debate. So what is the reality of that debate today? What is the reality of that intellectual debate, that intellectual clash which is existing in the West? And that clash, as I mentioned to you, it is part and parcel of Western society. As I mentioned to you earlier on, the segregation debate, the debate about Sharia, women's rights, all of these things are happening day and night. How many of us really understand what is the underlying concepts and ideas behind that debate? Like we understand in Islam, there are the pillars of Islam. We have the five pillars of Islam. How many of you really know the pillars of kufr today? If I was to ask you, what are the pillars of Western kufr today? There's also five pillars of Western kufr, by the way, if you didn't know. Number one, secularism, ilmaniyya. That is one of their pillars, which is their aqidah. Five pillars. This is it. Five pillars of kufr. Number two, freedom of speech. Freedom of speech. Number three, personal freedom. What does it say? Personal freedom. Number four, freedom of religion. And number five, freedom of ownership. The four freedoms which they covet, which is basically their foundations and their aqidah. These are the five pillars of kufr. So we know the five pillars of Islam, but do we really understand the five pillars of kufr today? And what that actually means? So secularism, separation from religion, from life's affairs. How many of us understand the arguments behind that? How many of us understand the evidence behind that? And how they attack Islam with that? Because their own experience with Christianity, where Christianity failed them in their own history, they've taken that worldview and applied it to Islam. Just because Europe failed under Christianity, they've made the arrogant assumption that Islam will fail the Muslims in the Muslim world today. That is their narrative. We need to be able to deconstruct that narrative. We need to be able to challenge that. The idea of freedom of speech, that you can say anything you like, it is one of their sacred cows. Really it is. But they think under freedom of speech, through freedom of speech, is how you actually account your rulers. Through freedom of speech, it is by which you can gain, you know, technological and scientific advances, because we allow freedom of thought. That's again their own perception, and they are imposing it in the rest of the world today. Didn't the Muslim Ummah in its history develop science and technology? We didn't have freedom of speech. We don't believe in freedom of speech. We believe in freedom to speak the haq, the truth. Only the truth, and nothing but the truth. Did we not account to our rulers, not because of freedom of speech, but because of Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi al Munkar? That gave us a mechanism of accounting our rulers and removing them. Therefore, we didn't need freedom of speech. So we need to know the pillars of kufr as well, in order to engage in that debate and that discussion, and to show the contradictions that exist. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was involved in this debate with the mushrikeen. And I want to show you this altercation, this debate that existed between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse, إِنَّكُمْ وَمَا تَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ حَسَبُ جَهَنَّمُ. Indeed, verily, you and what you worship other than Allah are fuel for Jahannam. When the mushrikeen, they heard this ayah, they became really happy. Became really happy. And one of them, his name was Abdullahi Zibara. He said, لا أخسمن محمدا. I will certainly defeat Muhammad. I will certainly defeat Muhammad. So فجاءوا فقال. He came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Said, يا محمد. قد عبد عيسى وعبدت الملائكة. فهل هم حسبوا لجهنم. Wasn't Isa worshipped? Wasn't Isa ibn Maryam worshipped? And the angels, were they worshipped? Surely they will be the fuel for the hellfire. Because the ayah said, anything that's been worshipped other than Allah, they are going to be fuel for the hellfire. So he thought he's found a contradiction in the Quran. He thought today he's going to have his way with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So today, people will find ayahs and hadith. And they will say, we're going to use the ayah and hadith and show the contradictions in Islam. Show the contradiction in Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, اقرأ ما بعد إن الذين سبقت لهم من الحسنى أولئك أنها معبدون. He said, read what came after these ayahs. Don't just pick and choose the ayah. Read what came after this ayah. What came after the ayah? Verily those for whom the good had preceded us, they're going to be far away from this. So he was just happy to quote this part of the ayah and go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, Isa ibn Maryam and the angels are going to be in the hellfire. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, look, read the rest of the ayah. He was involved in a debate and a discussion. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he qualified that debate and that discussion that billati hiya ahsan. Needs to be in the most superior manner, in the best way, this debate and that discussion. Because in debate and discussion, brothers and sisters, is that people's passions and their desires to win an argument overtakes them. That we are involved in that debate and discussion to establish the haq and to establish the truth. So that we should not get into any futile debate and discussion with anybody. We should stick to the points at hand and present the arguments and present the proof for our points. Not only that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then consoles the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by mentioning that if people, after your debate and your discussion and your good advice, people don't accept it, what should you do? Because you can easily become frustrated. You get into da'wah and people don't accept what you say. So what do? You just give up? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ ضَلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ. That verily your master, your Rabb, knows those who have gone astray from his path. He knows, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows who has gone astray from Islam, gone astray from the path of Islam. وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُحْتَدِينَ. And he also knows those who are guided. And this is very important, telling Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam things, which is that when you're involved in da'wah, and da'wah, by the way, it's a rewardless task. Let me tell you. It's a rewardless task. Because most of the time, people will not accept what you say. And especially today, when you are calling to Islam, before you even open your mouth, people have made up their minds. Muslims and non-Muslims alike. And you have to continue with this path. Now, as a human being, we get our motivation from the results of our actions. That's just a natural psychological thing that we have as a human being. Imagine you go to work, you're a businessman, you open your shop every day, you don't see any profits. How would you feel? You open every day. Or you go to work for somebody, he doesn't pay you at all. In the end, you're just going to say, you know what? Let's shut the shop down, or let me quit my job. Because why? Human beings, by their very nature, they want to see end results. They want to see the fruits of their labor. They want to see that. And we want to see that in the da'wah. When we're giving da'wah to Muslims, non-Muslims, we want to see them accept Islam, to follow Islam, to acknowledge your point. We want to see that. And that gives us motivation. But what happens if people are rejecting Islam? What happens if people don't want to listen to you? And you have to keep on doing this. It's going to affect your motivation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying to him that in the end, you carry this da'wah bil hikmah wa ma'udhat al hasana wa jahidtum billati hiya ahsan. You do all of that. In the end, if no one accepts Islam, you continue in that path. You continue in that struggle because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who guides. He is the one that opens the chest of people to Islam and to Iman. But you keep on this path. And this is really important for us because this struggle requires this patience and requires this steadfastness. And I want to finish off, inshallah ta'ala, as a hadith which I found very motivational, and a commentary also by Ibn Athir. Ibn Athir, he is a historian, he commented this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ بَدَعَ غَرِيبًا. Indeed, Islam began something غريب, strange. وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَعَ. And it will return something strange. Just like in the first time. It will return as something strange. فَتُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. So give glad tidings to the strangers. Ibn Athir, he commented on this hadith and it's really motivational. He said, Islam was something new for the society in which it was first appeared. Meaning the Meccan society, it was something new. A similar situation would return again one day. A similar situation will return again one day. And I think that this situation is really today, is our situation. It is a situation today where Islam is not implemented. It is a situation today where the Muslims are not united under one khilafah, under one system. It is a situation today where Islam is under attack constantly, and those who are trying to practice Islam are being characterized as extremists, as fundamentalists, and so forth. This is our situation. He said, the pious Muslims will be in the minority. The pious Muslims will be in the minority. However, this condition, this situation would be a golden chance for the pious people, in the sense that by performing their mission, they would be like the first generation of Muslims. It's a golden opportunity for us to be like the first generations of Muslims. And who are the first generations of Muslims? وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ. The very first generations of the Muhajirin and the Ansar. ومن اتبعهم بالإحسان and those who follow them. So if we want to have the honor and the dignity and the reward and the ajr, this is our time. This is our time to rise up to this challenge. They would be blessed with paradise for having resisted the forces of evil and bearing all forms of harm with sabr, with patience. And this is the reward and the ajr is awaiting those who are going to be on this path of calling people to the path of Allah Azza wa Jal بالحكمه ومعوذ الحسنه وجادلهم بالتي هي احسن وقولي قولي هذا استغفر الله العظيم